The topic is procedure for senior designation as laid down by Supreme Court 2017-9 SCC at page 766, Indira Jaisingh versus Supreme Court of India and others, and rules framed pursuant to the said judgment. The speaker is Ajit Kumar Sinha, senior advocate and former Supreme Court Bar Association Vice President, and our beloved senior. Earlier also several times he delivered lectures. So immediately, believe it or not, there is another speaker, but suddenly she had some problem. He accepted immediately, jumped into, and meanwhile the judgment also. And so many seniors also designate the list published. So that's a very correct, so that sir also accepted. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, 45 minutes your speech, 15 minutes question answer, then followed by. We'll go by one by one introduction, sir. Myself, Seshagiri Rao.
Rahul Sharma. Shekhar Pri Jha.
Meeraj Shivas.
Prasun Kumar Mishra.
Kundal
Lal. I'm Advocate Gora from Bombay. Bombay High Court.
Amit Pratap Singh.
Gupta Shyam Sundar.
Anita Bhakna.
Sir, I'm Advocate Roni Wang. I'm practicing Bombay High Court as well. I started here. I'm practicing since I was 25 years.
You're welcome more now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Give your blessing, sir.
All the best.
Please, Pishan Kumar Neeraj.
Sir, Rumapal.
Rumapal? Patan.
Myself,
Jyoti Parashar. Quickly, please.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Point. Amrit.
Rajesh Sharma.
Sunil Kumar. Ramaji.
Vivek Bhatt.
By the time now, I know most of the names.
Yes, but still,
Namaskaram, sir, welcome.
Ajit Kulshrest, sir.
Ajit Kulshrest.
Sir, now we go.
Thank you. As you all know, the topic is very relevant because it is of too much of interest for each and every advocate, since it concerns them. And the topic primarily is what is the procedure to be followed for senior designation in the light of the judgment of the Supreme Court. I hope I am audible at the back.
Yes, sir.
Now, since it is confined to the judgment and the following effect, which led to appointment of designation of 37 people, and what are the guidelines laid down pursuant thereto, and what were the hitch and what were the difficulties, and what was the contours of the challenge, I'll just first tell you some of the relevant provisions which were taken into consideration. Basically, the litigation was filed as to why you are creating a class within a class without any object sought to be achieved. So it violates Article 14 of the Constitution, and it also amounts to discrimination. That apart, then the Supreme Court invited majority of the High Courts Association to also be a part of it. Now they also challenge the vagaries of the enactment under the Advocates Act, and in particular Section 16(2). That was followed by challenge to the Supreme Court Rules Order 2, Rule 4. And that they made out a ground that there is no object sought to be achieved. You are creating disparity, discrimination by placing and conferring a status which is barred in the Constitution under Article 18 of the Constitution. So no conferment of title, they interpreted it as a title which you cannot confer. So that led to assimilating all the issues, and then the Supreme Court culled out in the judgment at page 274, I'll read those four issues for decision so that it settles the law once for all. They also challenge that why should it be confined to the Supreme Court who will decide this issue, and why don't you ask for the bar also to be participant in it, and their members should be adequately represented because they know the who's who and they know everyone, and they will contribute in the selection of each and every candidate in a proper and correct manner. Before I come to the judgment, I'll just show you three provisions of the Act which are germane to the present issue, and that was a subject matter of challenge as well. The first is the Advocates Act of 1961, which is 16-2, and the virus was challenged in this case by the association of Gujarat and some other states. Now 16-2 itself prescribed the guidelines. There is nothing new in it. Now one thing more, in the petition there was a specific challenge to the secret ballot system. In the petition, because earlier there used to be a secret ballot for voting, that was challenged that it is opaque, it can't be permitted. So 16-2 reads as under, I'll just read it for you, the provisions first, then come to the issues which has been culled out and framed. And the evolution, as one of the members asked me, how it evolved since British Raj. That also in one paragraph I'll sum it up. Section 16 reads as under, let me read it for you. There shall be two classes of advocates, namely senior advocates and other advocates. Now here in Supreme Court, other advocates includes advocate on record, non-advocate on record, and then senior advocates. So there are three types, which is contemplated and statutorily protected under the Advocates Act. Subsection 2 clearly specifies the criteria. An advocate may, with his consent, be designated as a senior advocate if the Supreme Court or a High Court is of the opinion that by virtue of his ability, 1. Standing at the bar, 2. Or special knowledge or experience in law, is deserving of such distinctions. Senior advocates shall, in the matter of their practice, be subject to such restrictions as the Bar Council of India may, in the interest of legal profession, prescribe. It also provides that an advocate of the Supreme Court who was a senior advocate of that court immediately before the appointed day shall, for the purposes of this section, be deemed to be a senior advocate. So three criteria were already inbuilt in the Act itself. One is standing, second is ability, and third special knowledge. But I must tell you, it was not well defined and it was not clear, rather ambiguous. Ability, standing at the bar, special knowledge or experience. This used to lead to some problems at times, and there was no clear-cut guidelines in the Supreme Court with regard to what should be the specifics of it to make you eligible to apply. Nor there was a construction or a structure of a permanent committee which was need of the hour. Then the Supreme Court rules, if you see, Order 2, Rule 4, which also specified some of the criteria, giving power to the Chief Justice and the judges to A. The Chief Justice and the judges may, with the consent of the advocate, designate an advocate as senior advocate if in their opinion, by virtue of his ability, standing at the bar, or special knowledge or experience in law, the said advocate is deserving of such distinction. It also laid down the criteria what they cannot do. They cannot file wakalatnama, all these were there, but this is not relevant for today's purpose. I am just spelling it out. Senior advocate shall not file a wakalatnama. This is under the Supreme Court rules. He cannot appear without an advocate on record or an advocate, whatever it is, or without a junior advocate. So these are the certain restrictions and limitations for the seniors, which is spelt out in the rules of the Supreme Court framed under Article 145. Accept instructions to draw pleadings, meaning thereby, I don't know whether it is being followed in that spirit or not, that they should not directly contact or be in touch with the clients, but they should be routed through the junior advocates or the advocate on record. So this is what the Supreme Court rules say. The third provision, which has been also referred to for challenging it, was Article 18. I don't have the constitution for the present. Your constitution, Mangal. Now, 18 disentitles a state to confer a status or a title. Thank you, dear. So what they said, that you are conferring a title by designating him as a senior advocate, which is barred under the provisions of the Constitution. I'll read it later. That was the third issue, which was also taken into consideration by the Supreme Court, that whether conferment of a designation to an advocate as a senior advocate amounts to conferring a title, which is barred under the Constitution. I'll request somebody to read that.
Yes, which problem, sir?
18.
Abolition of titles, one. Hmm? No titles, not being a military or academic distinctions.
Except that.
Shall be conferred by the state. Two. No citizen of India shall accept any title from any foreign state. Third, no person who is not a citizen of India shall, while he holds any office of profit or trust under the state, accept without the consent of the president any title from any foreign state. Four, no person holding any office of profit or trust under the state shall, without the consent of the president, accept any present, emolument or office or any kind from or any other foreign state.
So meaning thereby, whether it amounts to conferring a title or not. If it is a title being conferred by the state, then it is barred under the Constitution. That was the third issue. And the fourth issue was that this ballot system, secret ballot system, should be done away with. And transparency should be brought about by inviting application and putting it in the public domain so that each and every person knows what is happening. Earlier it used to not happen, but I must thank the Honorable Supreme Court to a considerable extent. Now it meets the test of natural justice. And if you compare it with the appointment of a judge, you will be aghast. For a senior advocate, the procedure is so cumbersome. For appointment of a judge, it is nothing. Only 10 years. That's all. So that's the stark distinction, which we are also praying that there also you should appoint a permanent committee and a secretariat. Let us see if it works out or not. But I am keeping it aside for the present, since we are confining to this issue. Now at page 774, the issues were called out in the judgment, which is 2017-9 SCC, page 766, for determination. And I must tell you, almost all the states of the country, their Bar Association, were put to notice and they were represented. The following prayers were made in totality, not only in Indira Jai Singh case, but other Meghalaya, Gujarat, Bombay, Jharkhand, UP, all the states, they summarized it into five issues. The first was, issue a writ of order or direction declaring that the system of designation of senior advocates by recently introduced method of vote is arbitrary and contrary to the notions of diversity, violating Article 14, 15 and 21. Therefore, it is unconstitutional and null and void. This was the original petition by Indira Jai Singh. She said this system itself is opaque and it should be reformed, corrected and modified. The second issue which was called out as an issue which the different states also prayed, that who all will be in the permanent committee, because there was a heated debate. In fact, I had the privilege of appearing in this matter, at that time being a vice president. We said that the bar should be represented either by bar president or somebody. But finally, I'll tell you what actually happened. But the second prayer was in fact called out, issue writ, order or direction for appointment of a permanent selection committee with a secretariat headed by a lay person, which includes respondent number 4, Attorney General for India, representatives from Respondent 5 SCBA and Respondent 6 AOR Association and academics. for the designation of senior advocates on the basis of an assessment made on a point system as suggested in Annexure P8. I'll answer what finally the judgment was, to what extent it was considered and to what extent it was in fact acceded to. I'll come later. The third prayer, which was summed up, issue a writ of mandamus or direction directing respondent number 1, representing the Chief Justice and judges of the Supreme Court, that is the Registrar General, appoint a search committee to identify the advocates who conduct public interest litigation, cases and advocates who practice in the area of their domain expertise, constitutional law, international arbitration, intercity disputes, interstate water disputes, cyber law, and to designate them as senior advocate. This issue in fact took about quite some time at the time of argument, because this was specifics that those who are specialized in those fields should be given a preference or a weightage, which was opposed, that when you are making an overall perception, when you are making an overall assessment, then why are you saying that those who only file PIL should be considered, those who are in international arbitration should be considered? So specifics can't decide the issue of senior designation. Let it be an overall concept. Since you are laying down the period, 10 years, since you are laying down the ability and the knowledge and experience in law, whosoever is regular and whosoever is visible can be considered. That was the third. Then D, issue a writ of mandamus or direction directing respondent number 1, representing the Chief Justice and judges of the Supreme Court, to frame guidelines requiring the preparation of an assessment report by the Peers Committee on the advocates who apply for designation based on an index 100 points. This was said, you give the breakup as to the point system and reintroduce that. And based on the point system, our past president is also here, based on the point system, you decide. And they also said that after you pass the judgment, lay down the rules and procedures and the guidelines so that it is known to the lawyers for being eligible and applicant. These were the 5 issues. After taking into consideration the entire country's Bar Association view, the State Association view, Bar Council's view, Supreme Court Bar Association, Advocate and Record Association, as well as some of the academicians also were called, and they decided. Now, some query was that how it has evolved. You all know earlier the conferment of title was a basic practice by the British Raj. Raj Bahadur title de diye. Something like that, it used to be always conferred. They used to give Jagir, they used to give Raj Bahadur title. That is why constitution consciously barred it. So that issue was also considered threadbare, that a prefix or a suffix to a name, does it mean a title? Now Ajit Kumar Sinha, senior advocate, it doesn't confer a title as such, and very nicely it was distinguished that it is not a title. Take for example a doctor. They are consultant, they are senior surgeon, they are surgeon, and there are many people who are junior surgeon. That doesn't mean that a title has been conferred. It is as per their capability, the ability, special knowledge, the experience, and the years put in, you are giving them that word which prefix or suffix to their names or the profession. So that is not a title. That is how it was answered. But how the practice of lawyers in this regard was evolved, it is a small history has been very nicely summed up at page 787. I'll just read that instead of detailing it, because you should know the background of its evolution. It's para 20 of the judgment, and you should read it because you will get at one place the entire scenario. The Chancery Court, the Supreme Court, before that 1962, how it evolved. It says, so far as India is concerned, it appears that the legal profession acquired roots in the years of British rule. The first British rule was established in Bombay in the year 1672. In the year 1726, the mayor courts were established at three places, as you all know, Madras, Bombay and Calcutta. Then came the Charter Court. And by the Charter of 1774, the Supreme Court of Judicature was established at Calcutta because British head was in Calcutta. So that is how the Chartered Court was established at Calcutta and thereafter in Bombay and Madras. So these were the three Charter Courts. The Charter allowed only English and Irish barristers to practice in these courts, and no Indian had the right to appear in that court at that time. In 1862, high courts were established at Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. Wakils could now practice before the high courts, ending the monopoly of barristers. There was Indian participation in the courts, along with the presence of English lawyers in 1879. The Legal Practitioners Act was enacted, which defined legal practitioner to mean an advocate, a wakil or attorney of any high court, a pleader or mukhtar, a revenue agent. Thereafter came the Indian Bar Council Act 1926, which was passed to unify the various grades of legal practice and to provide autonomy to the bar prior to the coming into force of the Advocates Act 1961. So far as the Supreme Court of India is concerned, designation as a senior advocate was a matter of choice for an advocate at that time, who had completed 10 years of practice and who was otherwise willing to abide by certain conditions, example, not to directly deal with clients or file papers and documents in the courts, etc. Designation which were exclusively dealt with by the bar came to be vested in the Supreme Court with the enactment of Supreme Court rules of the year 1966. Before that it was your volition with certain restriction. Similar was the earlier position in Bombay High Court. The change in the scenario could be attributed to the enactment of the Advocates Act, where under the task of designating senior advocate was for the first time statutorily entrusted to the Supreme Court and the High Courts. So it, for the first time, Supreme Court rules and the Advocates Act brought about the different yardstick and the guidelines for being conferred the designation of a senior. Till that time, there was nothing. Between the period of Bar Council Act 1926 and the Supreme Court Rules and Advocates Act, there was a hiatus in the sense that anybody could have applied only, rider was 10 years experience, with certain restrictions that you can't file and you can't do this. But it was not a sort of selection. You see, there is a difference between, as you all know, promotion and selection. Once it is a selection, then the yardstick are different. Promotion comes as a matter of right by lapse of time and seniority. It's a basic jurisprudence even in the service matter. But once it is a selection, then merit prevails. The criteria of merit comes into play. This is how it started. Now kindly see what finally they laid down the law. I'll just give you the details of 3-4 paragraphs of the judgment where they dealt with these issues and decided that no, the system will continue, but like this, not earlier it used to be nothing. We'll appoint a permanent committee, we'll give a space for permanent secretariat, and it will be a regular procedure every 6 months in a year, meaning thereby twice in a year, and there will be a committee constituted which will be the permanent committee. And the committee was by way of designation, except one who will be an SCBA member, meaning thereby one lawyer of repute to be decided by the Chief Justice or the judges, who will also participate. So the total number of 5 people were, in fact, of the permanent committee, were to be named, and they were the Chief Justice of India, 2 senior most judges, then the learned Attorney General for India, and one member of the bar. For the present, Mr. Panjwani knows it was Soli Sorabji. the distinguished member of the bar. So these were the five people. Now let me tell you, this is the step one. When they shortlisted the applicants, then it was to be referred to the full court. But there was a marked distinction for judges who have retired and have joined practice. In those cases, they were not to be tested by the committee in the first round. Straight away their names will go to the full court. There is a distinction between the two. That I'll give you from the guidelines which has now been codified. Not codified, but that is the guidelines which is binding. So meaning thereby, first and foremost, there will be a selection, shortlisting, all those who meet the eligibility criteria. Let me put it in a simpler way. Eligibility criteria was manifold. Those who meet that will be shortlisted based on their application, and then it will be sent to the full court, and there will be no secret ballot system, which was abolished as per this judge. Earlier it used to. And then they will come out with the people who have been cleared. There was another angle to it, that there should be also such cases which can be deferred. As I have a living example, Mr. Panjwani. Deferred will be considered again in the next sitting, depending upon how it is deferred. Once who is rejected, he cannot apply. He is eligible to apply only after 2 years. And there is another aspect to it. Those who have been deferred to apply again, that can be considered only after 1 year. So these were the three criteria. I'll show you from the rules, the guidelines. So what actually Supreme Court held, let me first read that, justifying and upholding the enactments, which was the subject matter of charge. That is, you can note down at page 788, 789, 799 and 800. And they laid down the points also, how to determine after considering the point-wise system for making a candidate eligible. At para 49 and 50, they dealt with Article 6, Section 16. You just make a note of it. And at para 53, they dealt with Article 18 of the Constitution. And para 55 onwards, they dealt with the criteria of eligibility, the roster, the point-wise system, and all those things to be followed by guidance. I'll just read the relevant portion. They said, the challenge to Section 16 of the Act and Order 4, Rule 2, that is para 50 specific, of the Supreme Court rules is primarily founded on the basis that the classification made resulting in two classes of advocates, senior advocates and advocates, is not based on any reasonable and acceptable basis. Even if there be one, the same has no connection with the object sought to be achieved by such classification. It is argued that not only the practice of designation of senior advocate is a relic of the feudal past, but it negates the concept of equality in as much as the professional qualification of a senior advocate and an advocate are the same, so as also the competence and ability in most cases. Yet a senior advocate, by virtue of his designation, stands out as a class apart, not only because of the special dress code prescribed, but also because of the right of pre-audience conferred by Section 23 of the Act. A senior advocate steals an undeserving head start. Kindly note the language. A senior advocate steals an undeserving head start in the profession. It is further contended that the designation of senior advocate being a conferment made by the judges, the same gives the impression of recognition of an advocate by the judges, which professionally has an adverse impact on others who have not been so designated, besides giving an unfair advantage to the person so designated. So these were the argument made. Then para 53. The practice of designation of senior advocate has also been challenged on the ground that the same violates Article 18 of the Constitution of India, which imposes an embargo on conferment of title by the state. Those state honours like Bharat Ratna, Padma Vibhushan, etc. are still being conferred. The said honours are not prefixed or suffixed to the names of the recipient. That is how they distinguish, unlike that of a senior advocate. The conferment of designation being an instance of exercise of administrative power of the Supreme Court and the High Court, the same is contrary to the mandate of Article 18. That's the second contention. Now, they have considered from para 55 onwards and have answered this in a very correct manner. The exercise of power vested in the Supreme Court and the High Court to designate an advocate as a senior advocate is circumscribed by the requirement of due satisfaction that the advocate concerned fulfills the three conditions stipulated under Section 16 of the Advocates Act. 1. Ability. 2. Standing at the bar. 3. Special knowledge or experience in law that the person seeking designation has acquired. It is not an uncontrolled, unguided, uncanalized power. Though in a given case its exercise may partake such a character, however, the possibility of misuse cannot be a ground for holding a provision of the statute to be constitutionally fragile. The consequence spelt out by the intervener, namely indulgence perceived to be shown by the courts to senior advocate, the effect of designation on the litigant public on account of high fees charged, its baneful effect on the junior members of the bar, the element of anti-competitiveness are untoward consequences occasioned by human failures. Possible consequence arises from a wrong, improper exercise of power cannot be a ground to invalidate the provisions of Section 16 of the Act. Recognition of qualities of merit and ability demonstrated by in-depth knowledge of intricate questions of law, fairness in court proceedings consistent with the duties of a counsel and an officer of the court, and contribution in assisting the court to charter the right course of action in any given case, all of which could go to determine the standing of the advocate at the bar, is the object behind the classification. Such an object would enhance the value of the legal system that advocates represent, so long as the basis of the classification is founded on reasonable parameters which can be introduced by way of uniform guidelines to be laid down by this court and they upheld. What they actually meant to say, that there is a reasonable classification for an object sought to be achieved, it's the test of Article 14. The concept of unjust, unfair and unreasonable cannot apply. Because here is a quality-related conferment coupled with the seniority and knowledge, which comes by way of experience. And if you go on looking at the failures, then every system has good and bad. But that can't be the determining effect to nullify the system itself. So actually they said that yes, they may be failures, but that doesn't mean the system is bad. Every institution will go if we uphold these arguments. Likewise, they also said 18 does not apply. As I have already said, that is, I dealt with 57. Now finally, I come to the most interesting part, which also in the judgment they have laid down, but the guidelines which finally was published and the Registrar General circulated. You should note each and everything so that in future all of you, yes, when occasion, can apply. Because that is the most important thing. First thing they laid down, that there has to be a permanent committee. And who all will be in the permanent committee? Chief Justice of India A as chairperson, two senior most judges,
of the Supreme Court. Simultaneously in the High Court, same thing will follow. Attorney General for India and a member of the bar as nominated by the chairperson and members. Here we had our reservation. I must tell you, I must confess the fact. Mr. Suri has left. He appeared in the matter along with me. We said then if the chairman himself is to decide, then the bar should also be taken into confidence so that we also contribute to it, and a bar representative should be there. It has to be a lawyer, but take the views of the bar. And why not the president of the bar or the vice president of the bar? But finally it was resolved. And they said, no, a member of the bar will be there, no doubt. But to be nominated by the chairman, that is Chief Justice. Then the second prayer was also acceded to, that why this night, fly-by-night system, sometimes you sit, sometimes you don't. Let there be a permanent secretary where people know and apply. Because you are making it twice in a year, then it should be known to all of the applicants where to apply. So they considered it and agreed with us. And they said the committee shall meet at least twice in a calendar year and they will have a permanent secretariat. And the composition of permanent secretariat, that is the staff and all those, was to be decided by the Chief Justice and other members of the committee. Now, just make a note of para 6. There is some ambiguity in it, which needs some clarification. Total discretion is left with the Chief Justice and any other judge. It's not only Chief Justice. Who is in the opinion that A or B or C is deserving, they can directly recommend him for the full court. What it actually reads, I must read it for you, for your appreciation and also for critical assessment. If the Chief Justice or any other judge is of the opinion that an advocate by virtue of his ability, standing at the bar or special knowledge or experience in law, is deserving of such distinction so as to be designated as senior advocate, the Chief Justice, the judge may in writing recommend the name of such advocate for being considered for designation as senior advocate. Such recommendation will be submitted to the secretary. So this was a slight departure in the sense that they can also do it if they are of the opinion that this man deserves it. It may be good, it may be bad, but then the power is with them also to recommend. Then 7 is an advocate on record. Advocate seeking conferment of distinction has to submit in the prescribed format and the application as provided in the permanent secretariat twice in a year, provided you are not rejected or provided your case has not been put off for 1 year or deferred. Each year it is in the month of January and July, make a note of it, when you are given 15 days time to apply. Now it is irrespective of the fact that when they will sit it will happen, no. This is good. You know it by virtue of this being followed by the Supreme Court guidelines itself, that you can apply in the month of January and July to the Secretariat Committee and they will invite application and it is on the website and you can apply. Now comes the notice inviting application also is issued and thereafter you will be given only 15 days time after the notice is given, which will be displayed in the Supreme Court itself. Now nowhere. It will be in the Supreme Court Bar Association office, the AOR Association office, the Registrar's office. So meaning thereby it has confined it to these places because it is confined to Supreme Court advocates, where you can see and apply within 15 days from the date of calling for the application. Now the main eligibility criteria is in para 11.
the first eligibility criteria is minimum of 10 years combined standing as an advocate or a district and session judge, because some people leave and come. So altogether it should be minimum of 10 years to be eligible. Then for the judges, it should be he has been a chief justice or a judge of a high court. Their applications are different. Now on receipt of application, a sort of character certificate is also called for, which with regard to reputation, conduct, integrity of the advocate. Concern including his or her participation in pro bono work, judgment, reported and unreported, in which the advocate concerned had appeared, the number of such judgment for the last 5 years. So this says that you will complete the relevant data and information by giving your conduct, reputation, integrity, certificate. But it doesn't say who will give it. You yourself. My reading is that. It says, on receipt of application received from advocate on record, hear it very carefully. Or advocates the proposal received from Honorable Judges of Supreme Court, the Secretariat will compile the relevant data and information with regard to. So, you give it, the Secretariat will also do it. My understanding is this. It says the Secretariat will compile the relevant data and information with regard to the reputation, conduct, integrity of the advocate. Concern, including his, her participation in pro bono work and also your reported and unreported judgment. You have actually dealt with law and argued in the court and your name figures in the court. Such reported judgments for the last 5 years is to be given. This is very important to make you eligible, not only eligible, rather to go through, because this is to be scrutinized. As regards your reputation, conduct also, they will collect the data and information, which you will find in the next two paragraphs. The data as referred to in para 12 above will be sought and collected by the Secretariat from the sources as may be decided by the committee. Now supposingly if Mr. Seshu, you apply, I'm just giving you a living example. You fulfill all the criteria. 10 years is the minimum you fulfill. Your character reputation certificate is there. You also fulfill the eligibility, your ability is there. Your judgments are reported. But that is not the end. The committee will also verify it. From sources. Sources means your colleagues, your reputation at the bar or before the bench. That is para 13. The data as referred to in para 12 above will be sought and collected. Sought means what you are giving. Collected from sources means their discussion. In a way it is correct also. That some of the information, if I speak for myself, I will always generally speak high about me. That's the human psychology, unfortunate to say so, but it is. So this is also the need of the hour. So they will collect some information and compile it. They are not the deciding factor. They will compile it to be placed before the committee. They are not deciding against you. They will say these are the sources which has informed me about the gentleman who is an applicant to be considered. But then two sources come. One is your as a bona fide applicant and one is their sources. Both clubbed together presented candidate. I hope I am clear. That is very important here. And it was a need of the hour. They said if you don't do that, tomorrow if one person is unfortunately appointed who is not deserving, then people will blame us. Because everything has two sides. Na? 14 also became important. The Secretariat will publish the proposal all those proposals will be published. So it is not opaque anymore further. Of designation of a particular advocate in the official website of the court, inviting suggestions as the third restriction. Views of other stakeholders in the proposed designation. Now this is a further check that your names of the applicant will be published on the website. There may be other stakeholders, somebody is against you, his view is also called, and he will point out that no, Mr. Seshu is hardly argued. Somebody may say something, no, his character certificate. So like that, that is also kept open. For the other stakeholders in the proposed designation to give their viewpoint of those people who are enlisted to be sent for being considered for being designated. So that's the third rider or check, I can tell you. So it's not a smooth sailing, I must tell you, it's the third rider. And these stakeholders are who? Us. And you know lawyers. Somebody may try to find fault with you, somebody may point out, no, this was not correct. And if it is proved to be not correct, you will be declared ineligible. So that's the third rider. Then finally, it will be 15 days time for those stakeholders to come up, not beyond that. So 15 earlier, 15 days. 15 days time for the stakeholder, then it is compiled finally to be sent. A database is made in terms of para 12 to 14, compiled by the secretariat, and all such information. So three information, yours as an applicant, the sources of the registrar general, and the stakeholders' comment. All these are compiled and sent before the committee for the candidate to be considered. The secretariat shall put up the case before the committee for scrutiny. Now this committee is not the full court, as I have already explained it to you. These are the five people who will finalize, and then it will go to the full court for endorsement. The committee will examine each case in the light of the data provided by the secretariat and call them for interview and selection. Interact, in fact, interview and interact. This time I was told, Mr. Panjwani will correct me, there were 108 people who were called in three phases, 35 each and 36. Sometimes 105, yes, 35 each, you are right. So in three lots, but it got delayed because sometimes Justice Bobde was unwell, sometimes Solicitor Abhi was unwell, so it got a little more time. And they did it in three lot. And it was finally, when I asked one of the judges, they said it is only to recognize the face also, that is familiar to the court. Once we see many names, we don't remember. But once we see, we find out, yes, yes, he appears regularly. That's a good way. So that is an interaction. Not primarily an interview, but it's an interaction. And once they come to us, I can easily make out, yes, yes, he is with us. So that is the actual basis for determining by interacting with them and the familiarity of being confined to the Supreme Court. This is how it, and then they gave out the criteria for giving marks based on each criteria, how much marks will be allotted, which is very important. So everything is crystal clear, nothing opaque. If you have completed 10 years, then you get 10 points. 10 to 20 years is 10 points. You can make a note. If you have this, you can get it. And above 20 years, you will get 20 points. So if your experience is more than 20 years in the bar, then you get 20 marks. But if it is between 10 to 20, you will get 10 marks. Then your reported and unreported judgments, there are two different ways of judging it. your reported and unreported judgment, where by your name some legal formulation has been made and reported in the judgment, that is very relevant. It says so. They have clarified it, not that your name only figures. In many cases nowadays people put 10 names. But in the midst of that argument and the legal argument and legal formulation, your name should certainly be there, that the such and such counsel has raised these legal issues for kind consideration. And that is how they have made 40 points for it, the maximum, which I think is correct also. And I'll read you, for you, what does it actually mean. Judgments reported and unreported, which indicate, this is very important, the legal formulations advanced by the advocate concerned in the course of the proceedings of the case. Pro bono work done, this also has been given weighted. At least you should also do pro bono work. That also you can indicate that I have done, appeared for legal aid, I have appeared for such and such poor people case. Amicus court has appointed you. Then the advocate concerned, domain expertise of the applicant advocate in various branches of law, such as constitutional law, interstate water disputes, criminal law, arbitration law, corporate law, family law, human rights, public interest litigation, international law relating to women, etc. So this is how they have made it in totality, 40 points for your expertise in different fields, your legal formulation and your reported judgments or unreported. Then if you have published any journal, any article or any book, you can indicate, you will get 15 points for that. Then comes the test of personality and suitability on the basis of interview and interaction, that is 25. So the total is 100, and the breakup, once again I will repeat it, 20 is for period of practice, 40 is for your judgments and your argument and your expertise in the field of law. Your publication, your journals or your articles or your books, that is 15. Your test of personality and suitability is 25. These are the breakup based on which you will be through. But it doesn't say anything as a cutoff point, that if you secure 60, you are through. That they have left it, they have not indicated. Generally, it should have been done. Generally, because even in AOR, you see 60%, you are through. Likewise, we feel that you should indicate that also, so that people who secure more than 70 or 60 are eligible. Something in that regard is required. That's our suggestion. Now, all these names that are listed before the committee, cleared by the committee, will go to the full court, as I have already indicated. And the retired judges and chief justices' names will go straight away to the full court. That is in paranoia. 20 points out that voting by secret ballot will not normally be resorted to by the full court, which was the earlier practice, except when unavoidable. Ab kabhi judges mein bhi ladai ho jati hai. You see, there may be difference of opinion in some candidates. There may be no, he can't be, likes and dislikes may have happened. Only when it is unavoidable, then only secret ballot, otherwise. In the event of resort to secret ballot, decisions will be carried by a majority of the judges who would choose to exercise their preference choice. So only in that case, it will be by majority of the voting. But that is not the now normal practice, that also is clear. All cases which may not be favorably considered, this is very important, by the full court shall be reviewed reconsidered after expiry of a period of 2 years. Meaning thereby, not favorably considered is a use of a language, meaning thereby rejected. He can be again eligible to be considered for being reviewed, for being designated, only after 2 years, not before that. That is para 21. Para 22 says all those cases which may be deferred by the committee for being designated a senior advocate shall not be considered until expiry of 1 year from the date of deferment. I must tell you, in this group also, 11, 12 have received such letter and they were asking me, and I told them that you can't be considered in July. They were not agreeing to me, but I said you can't. Because all such, because the language of the letter which you receive is very important. Your case is deferred, then you will be considered only in the next January, not before that. But if it says that your case will be considered in the next sitting, then in July. I believe some of them have received such letters. Mr. Panjwani has received. So this fact I have clarified to some of the aspirants who could not be, they were not agreeable to me. But I say no. The language of the letter will determine whether it is rejected, whether it is deferred, or whether it is to be considered in the next meeting. If it is in the next meeting, then it will be July. If it is deferred, after 1 year. And if it is not favorably considered or rejected, only after 2 years.
Only after 2 weeks.
Two years. Reject होने के बाद आप 2 weeks में जाते हैं. So now, and the retired chief justices and judges who have taken full time assignment, they are not to be considered.
क्या कोई format होगा?
Format जो application का.
Judges.
Yes, that they get it on the website.
Yeah, it is.
15 days before. From the registrar's office, and it is also in the website of SCBA, AOR Association, as well as Secretary General's website. It is proper publication. Anybody can upload it and fill up the form, and online you can apply. No problem. Retired Chief Justices of the High Court who have accepted any full-time assignment will not be considered. Because some people join NGT or somebody joined somewhere. Yes. And all will be communicated the full court decision, as you know. And finally it says, in the event a senior advocate is found guilty of conduct which according to the full court disentitles the senior advocate to continue to be worthy of designation, the full court may review his decision to designate the person concerned and recall the senior. So that power they have retained. You know that famous case of Delhi High Court, R.K. Anand and the other
one. And Ayuka.
Ayuka.
Same panel or new panel?
Any panel. Whosoever is existing, Chief Justice can be different also after that lapse of time.
If you are
because the new Chief Justice will... It is by designation that you are part of the committee. So this is in broad perspective. I need not comment upon the correctness of that's not my domain today, but I have only tried to enlighten you that in case if you are interested to apply, then these are the eligibility criteria, these are the yardstick, these are the guidelines, and these are the law declared pursuant to which this has been framed, which holds the field. So we are bound. Any query?
Sir, one query.
Now,
is any candidate any candidate apply to Supreme Court as well as to High Court for the designation?
For the High Court, it is the same thing but separate. If you are practicing here, only at one place. It is silent, but I can tell you from my experience.
If members are,
if you apply in the High Court,
yeah, if
simultaneously,
the
saying,
member of the High Court Bar Association also.
You see, you can apply, but then you'll have to disclose it. Earlier, there was no system of any application as such. But now in the application form, you'll find that column.
Yes.
So you'll have to disclose.
Like Chamarala.
You can apply, there is no bar. Supposingly, I am from Jharkhand. I can apply there. I am a member of the bar. But now the new format itself will indicate, have you ever applied?
Yes,
that it is. Earlier, since there was no formatting, no application, so it used to be concealed, let me put it very frankly. Yes.
Normally nowadays, normally do not reject, they say it is deferred. During the deferred period, whether they can apply to some other...
So it doesn't say deferred, when they are not considering it, it has not been favorably considered, meaning thereby it is rejected.
But they normally do not use rejected.
No, that is there.
In that intervening period...
No, you cannot apply. 2 years time is required as per the guidelines to be again eligible to apply. Minimum of 2 years. But if it is deferred, 1 year. That is what the guidelines say. So,
sir, it's normally allowed after 1 year.
It's a comments by stakeholder means what? Positive or negative?
It
or
can be both ways.
Both
ways.
So we can solicit as well.
You see, what happens when it is put in the public domain and some of your friends see, he has applied. They may also say, he is a very good candidate, I can vouch for him. It can be both ways, positive and negative. So don't take it always on the negative side. They may be good people. They may be people who are genuinely knowing you and genuinely trying to help you by giving their comments. But at times the stakeholders means some of your competitors also can be there.
Sometimes more negative works favorably.
It can be.
After
every 6 months. Every 6 months, that is in January and July. Every 6 months they will invite application, giving you 15 days time to apply for it. And it will be published also, it will be on the website also, it will be in the CBA office.
No maximum
declaring number of vacancies also?
No, there is no vacancy.
Results time.
People were saying itna, too many people have been given this, that, but then after 4-5 years, 37 has been given, nothing bad.
Nothing.
Yes.
Sir, what is the maximum
good
time?
Good
for each declaring about.
There is no maximum time for applying. You will get, if you have more than 20 years experience, more points. That's all.
Yeah. No, if someone is 85.
If he is still coming to court and he
can
is
apply.
All well, he can certainly apply. What is wrong?
And from this judgment only it has come.
Yes. In the judgment it is mentioned.
The age has been removed.
Is there any results time?
There is nothing of an age bar.
After scrutiny and everything, there is a time bound for declaring results?
Yes, before the next meeting.
Before the next
meeting. It has to be done, you see, generally. January they are inviting it, 30 days time itself is consumed as per the guidelines. Thereafter it goes to the permanent committee for the first rider. Then the permanent committee sends it to full court. So full court generally in a month sits twice, as I know. So depending upon the availability of the full court, so 2-3 months is the minimum I am expecting, or rather more, because then there has to be an interaction or interview also, because that is also now mandated. So that also entails time. When those 5 people join together, if there are 100 applicants, it can't be done at a one go. So that also consumes time. So make it a point that it should be January, before July it has to be declared.
So is there any evidence or the history that so much of somebody has been elevated in the court without applying it?
Yeah, so many.
Many judges have been appointed. Yeah. Even in the present scenario, you have 3 judges.
So in Supreme Court, but in some other high court, somebody is arguing and so much he has been conferred. There is no history.
That is a difficulty because Supreme Court has 142 and 142.
It
never happened in the High Court.
Sir, he shifted from senior advocate to judge, sir.
Now he has diverted himself. We are on the senior advocate. We are not discussing that.
Sir, we thought it is slip of word.
No.
He asked me for the reason that whether they can straight away without following this, I could understand, appoint somebody as senior.
Because when I was new to profession, Naresh Kaushik told G.D. Gupta, he was practicing in PAT,
that Amitabh had to propose Jaya Bhadri. So you have to apply for this Queen's Board. Unless you do it.
Now it is mandatory.
It is mandatory now.
Earlier it was not mandatory. Now it is mandatory, you have to apply. Earlier I can cite three, four examples
are there, no?
Where they were called and conferred. Rohington was.
Are you interested? That's it.
Only thing, they are called and asked. Rajiv Dhawan was given.
Even Justice Lalit was also called by Justice Khare. Why not you are applying for this seat? On open court.
Rajiv Dhawan. Then one more, I am forgetting his name.
P.N. Mishra also.
P.N. Mishra also.
Yes, you are right.
P.N. Mishra also.
He was at the verge of getting the chamber. In
from
the
G.V.
Patnaik.
So, you see, earlier it was not a system where you had guidelines or the framework or the application based on which you can apply.
Now it is
in a way, I am using the loose expression of codified for the reason that this is laid down by none other than the Supreme Court. They are also bound by it.
Democratized.
It is more democratized. Now they cannot pick and choose. You look better, I'll appoint you. No. Earlier, somebody is exceptionally good, they used to call and confer. That is over now. Because of this judgment and because of these guidelines, you have to apply for it. There are many people who have not applied and they are very good in the sense they have not been given.
So this will give ultimately good results, sir? Forget about the 37.
I think so. My perception to these guidelines and the regulations is that at least there is full transparency. You know who all have applied, so that nothing springs as a surprise. Uska kaise ho gaya? It happens.
Exactly.
That is completely finished. So there is full transparency.
Yes.
The opaqueness which used to prevail has been brought to an end. So the positive aspect, always don't be pessimist, be optimistic. Why I tell you? Something positive has been done, we should appreciate.
Okay.
Appreciate in the sense, today anybody can be an applicant.
Yeah.
Earlier you used to think 10 times, kya fayda apply karne ka? I may not get it.
Yeah.
Who will know me? Now if you fulfill the criteria, only 25% marks will be for the interview. Rest if you fulfill it, and you have published some good article and journal or books, even though you have appeared less, you can be in the 40 marks.
What about this pro bono cases, deliberately choosing and filing wrong, then how can you judge, sir?
No, that is one of the criteria. Now that they have clarified in para 19.
Okay.
Pro bono public, in fact, it is a more or less a public interest.
Public interest litigation.
Now, like supposedly,
one second.
Now, amicus may you are appointed. There is a difference. Amicus means you are a friend of the court.
Court.
Yes.
Where
but
the court appoints. But yes, but where the court appoints.
It's
not necessarily. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. One minute. It's only PIL.
It's a sort of. No. Supposingly, if somebody.
Leave it, please.
Somebody has not applied. Meaning thereby, they are litigants in person. And the court says, no, he needs a counsel, I appoint you. Mr. Sinha, you assist. Amicus is that. He may be given, somebody said, no, I will not charge anything. But pro bono is for when your discretion is there. You choose to appear free of cost for a public-spirited matter which concerns the society at large. Then it is pro bono.
Who will give
sort
the
of PIL.
Who will give the certificate whether it was a pro bono or not?
You have appeared.
Appeared, that is the proof. Your petition.
Now, supposedly you are appearing for legal aid matters.
Yes,
it's
pro bono. Mostly
legal
aid matters
is paid, sir.
No, paid. Pro bono it will come because legal aid matter is there.
There also lawyers
are. You are paid, but that is a prescribed fee. But pro bono is one where you choose to appear.
Sir, one. Suppose a matter is there. As you rightly pointed out in earlier illustration, court finds that the lady or the person who is not able to argue the matters or represent himself. So he requests you, yes, Mr. Sinha, you represent the case of this. Are you amicus curiae or are you pro bono?
No, that's amicus. The court's
so then pro bono has to be started from you.
Yes. That is also one of the ground when you can say that I was appointed amicus in such such a matter.
By the court. Again, order itself speaks.
And the order you have to annex it.
Sir, if an advocate settle the matter outside the court, then in that case we will get benefit or not?
Mediation, if it is referred to by the court, whether by the High Court or the trial court or the Supreme Court, and if it is settled, then only. Outside what you have done, there is no record. That may not, in fact, help you. And public interest litigation, you know, this mostly it is private interest litigation. These things.
Correct.
Let me put it bluntly. Except for 5% or 10%.
2%. In one of the public interest litigation, I specifically mentioned. So, I am doing it pro bono.
There's political interest litigation, private interest litigation.
5 lakh rupees for
all these things. They may be 10% genuine, rest may not be there. But then these are to be discerned, considered by the committee. When they actually give you the value for your contribution in that 40 marks. Now somebody is appearing in Dabhol case, Rafal case. It is also a public interest litigation. Because the economy of the country is involved. These are things to be determined by them, not by us. You can give that, yes, I appeared for bootleggers, I appeared for poor people on the street.
Or you are highlighting some scam sort of thing.
So that is also PIL, in a sense pro bono, that you can give it. You have to compile it and enclose it with the application. But overall, now I'll sum it up, it is a good step where all of us know the dates, the copy of the application and the applicants and who is to decide your fate. So it is not no more opaque, it is pure and simple, transparent, just, fair and reasonable to a considerable extent. That's my submission, in the sense submission to sum it up. Now at least you know June mein aayega, July mein aayega. Now you know January mein aayega. You can apply. You can upload the application, fill the form, give based on the criteria, your credentials. It has to be considered. And you will be also given the marks. Why you qualified, why you were disqualified. And the best part is that after a lapse of 2 years, you are not ruled out, you can again apply. I think that's the best part. Unless you are barred by some law, you are willing to, you are taken as again to be eligible to apply after that. Seshu, I think I have summed it up. Any further query or we close it? Thank you.
The institution.